Your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. You have taught children and infants to tell of your strength, silencing your enemies and all who oppose you. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them? Human beings that you should care for them? Yet you made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority. The flocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth.
If I could give you a glimpse into my mind, it would sound like a chaos of thoughts, things, people, and expectations all competing for my attention. Sometimes the to-do list is long. The dishwasher needs unloading. I need to buy some groceries. The dirty clothes are waiting to be put in the washing machine. There's an email that needs responding to. There's an exam that needs studying for, or maybe it's trying to maintain the relationships in my life with my boss, colleagues, teachers, peers, family, friends, everyone holding different expectations of me and different deadlines that always seem to clash with each other. Or maybe it's the anxious thoughts vying for my attention, the way they make me retreat and hold on to fear, the way they isolate me and create this tension in my chest, all of these thoughts going unseen, keeping me in my head and taking up my attention. I wonder what this sounds like for you. How often, when all of this is going on, do we get to slow down, pause, and look at the beauty around you? It sounds so simple, or maybe even unimportant to you, but in our busyness, it can be something that's so easily forgotten. I wonder if we're missing out on the beauty around us, and in turn, missing out on a revelation of God's character. Today, through looking at Psalm 8 together, I want to explore the importance and the impact of creation and how this stirs up a response within us. So as we move into a time of reflection, I want to invite you into a moment of Selah. Throughout the Psalms, Selah is a moment of breath, of pause, a time for reflection. We will do this a few times throughout our time together today, but this one will be the longest. So if you are able, could you please place both your feet on the ground and join me in closing our eyes together, and we're going to take some time to breathe. Breathe in, ha ki roto. Breathe out, ha ki waho. Breathe in, ha ki roto. Breathe out, ha ki waho. In, ha ki roto. Out, ha ki waho. Ha ki roto. Ha ki waho. Ha ki roto. Ha ki waho. And just let your breath find its place as you keep your eyes closed. And as you find yourself in the moment, it's like you're opening a door to a room. And in that room is a party filled with lots of people. Each person in that room represents a thought. Maybe it's discomfort from this moment, an expectation, or something that needs doing after church. As you walk through the door, each person is trying to pull you aside for a conversation. At the end of the room is Jesus. He's waiting there for you, a smile on his face as he sees you walking towards him. And as each person starts trying to talk to you, you just acknowledge them and you keep walking towards him. O Yahweh, our Yahweh, How majestic is your name in all the earth. O Yahweh, our Yahweh, how majestic is your name. O Yahweh, our Yahweh. Thank you, God, for who you are. Thank you that even though there are so many things vying our attention, you still wait graciously for us, inviting us closer and deeper with you. Would you open our eyes and our ears today to what you'd like to say to us? That way you may begin to be more sensitive to your creation around us. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. How many of you got to go away over summer? Maybe a few people got to go camping? Anyone happened to make it overseas? Oh yeah, a couple people, stirred. Maybe some people had a staycation, stayed around Auckland, just hung out. No one, wow, okay. did anyone happen to look at the night sky while they were away? Random, yeah, nice. I'm sure there was lots of delicious food shared, maybe a few board games, hopefully a few laughs too. I was lucky enough to do some volunteering with Red Frogs down in central Otago. And around that area of the country happens to be some of the best blackout spots in New Zealand. Now, a blackout spot is where there is minimal light pollution. So this means that at nighttime, the solar system is way more visible than in other parts of the country. We finished our shifts over New Year's around 2 a.m. each night, so it meant I could catch a glimpse of the night sky before going to bed. I wonder if you can recall a time, either recently over the summer or maybe in the past, where you stood beneath the night sky and just stopped. You look up and you see the dark navy blue, the shimmer of the stars, the glow of the moon. You start thinking about the vastness of the sky, the universe, just how infinite it all seems. I wonder how you felt. There's this tree in Newmarket, looks kind of similar to this. I pass it by when I get ice cream in the area, so we can call it my ice cream tree. Every time I go past this tree, I am stopped in my tracks. This tree is so beautiful. Now, there are plenty of these trees around Auckland. You might have seen some of these yourself. They're pretty common. So I don't know why this one's different for me. Maybe it's the fact that there's ice cream involved. But I really enjoy this tree. It's huge and bright and so intricate when you get up close. It also must be so old to be so big. Something stirs within me when I stand beneath that tree, and I kind of feel like a child. Psalm 8, verse 3 says, "When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place." The night sky, the ice cream tree, God has put so much effort, time, and thought into the world. Are you aware of the beauty that surrounds us? Do you ever slow down and think about how beautiful things are? Creation is an echo of God's beauty. I'm reminded of the quote, "Stop and smell the roses." This is a phrase I've heard plenty over the years. Seems simple, pretty straightforward. But when I took a moment to actually look at this phrase, I think it's a bit deeper. Stopping to smell the roses is really an act of appreciation and a moment to recognize the source of goodness in our lives. An act of appreciation and a moment to recognize the source of goodness in our lives. Simply taking a moment to stop and look at the night sky or the ice cream tree allows a moment of reflection and an opportunity to acknowledge God's goodness. Let's take a few more breaths together. Ha ki roto. Ha ki waho. 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 Verse 4. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. Have you ever had that feeling when you're looking at the night sky? Wow, I am so small. What you see in front of you is so incredible. It's created by a God so huge and majestic. And how could a God so big, capable of creating this, care for me? If you were here for Mike Pilavachi last week, you would have heard him speaking about the times he fails, and isn't that true for all of us? But as he also mentioned, when we look at what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12, when I am weak, then I am strong. When we are at our lowest, our weakest, God is infinitely stronger than we are. God loves to elevate the powerless, the weak, so that he can shine his light to the world through them. Even at our weakest moments, God sees us and shows his power through us so that he can be glorified. The psalm goes on, verse 5 and 6. You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the world, or over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet. Psalm 8 is spoken to God the Creator. Here, the psalmist is referring to the creation of human beings and how God designed our purpose. Let me read Genesis 1, 26 and 27 and see if you can pick up on the similarities. Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And then in verse 31, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. People were created with intention and purpose. God didn't accidentally make human beings. In fact, he chose to elevate us so that he could work through us. We are chosen. And not only that, but God thought that this creation of his was very good. How often do we forget in our busyness and in our crowded mind that God has chosen us, that God is pleased with us? God saw what he'd made and went, yep, that's it. Those are my sons and daughters. I think sometimes, similar to when we stand beneath the night sky, we can end up feeling insignificant or forgotten. When creating the world, God paid attention to the details, and he still does today. He created with time, effort, and thought. To create something, it needs to have intention, and you have to give it your focus. Psalm 139 says, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. God knew what he was doing when he created you. He created you in his own image. He was also thinking of you when he sent his son into the world, when Jesus sacrificed his life so that we may have eternal life with him in heaven. He had you in mind. I can imagine him thinking, this child of mine who isn't walking the earth yet and is loved by me and is a key part of my creation. I do this for them. What an incredible act of love. If you're hearing this psalm today and you are currently in a season of life where praising or appreciating beauty feels like the absolute last thing you can do, I want to talk to you about what surrounds this psalm. Psalm 8 is the first one of its kind in the book of Psalms. Now, this is a huge book with over 150 different psalms of varying lengths and sizes. However, the five psalms before and the six psalms after Psalm 8 are filled with a completely different tone. In these other psalms, David is crying out to God about the pain and suffering he is experiencing. He is powerless, he is oppressed, and he is joined by other people who are poor and afflicted. These psalms hold a sense of lament and deep hurt. And yet, this psalm that is filled with praise finds itself in the middle, surrounded by the cries of God's people. If only for a moment, or nine verses, all of the darkness and suffering and weight are driven away by the powerful vision that is God. Suddenly the tone shifts, and God takes the whole focus of the psalmist. His creative outworking and his incredible care for people becomes forefront. A couple years ago, I was supporting one of my best friends through his battle with depression. It was a pretty dark time for him, and as a friendship group, we did our best to surround him and help him up on the days where he needed a bit extra. What I experienced during this time was completely different to him, but I still experienced days where I was confused where hope and beauty were in that situation. I remember a specific day when I was walking to Polytech, really stuck in my thoughts, crying out to God. I had a thought pop into my head. Even in the hard times, God remains the same. And that's where I found hope that day. That even in the middle of what felt like chaos, there are reasons to praise God. He was still faithful, still good, still worthy of my praises, even though the situation felt horrible. He hadn't forgotten my friend, and he wasn't ignoring my prayers. Rather, God was desiring to use it for his good. These thoughts, realizations, came into my mind like a moment of praise surrounded by lament. It turns out that I didn't have to look too far to find beauty that day. That day I found beauty in God's character, beauty in his consistency, and in his persistent love. We have had some quite chaotic weather in Auckland over the past couple months. Not sure if you noticed. There has been a lot of rain, a bit of hail here and there, plenty of wind to go with it. Fortunately for you, if you like a sunny summer, there's been a few days for you too. We are currently in a season of what meteorologists call La Nina. La Nina is a naturally occurring global climate phase, along with its opposite phase, El Nino, together creating a climate cycle. Each phase shows up every few years and can last up to a year or two. La Nina is what has been causing our damp, wet days in the North Island. Whilst these two climate phases are somewhat predictable when we look at their history, the National Institute of Water and Atmospheric Research states that neither of these two systems are ever the same. We learn to anticipate their arrival and their leaving with only an idea of what they might be like. The weather we have been experiencing has felt unpredictable, but there is an assurance that it will change. Similar to this, whilst we don't know when our circumstances might change, we have assurance that God is with us in the thick of the storm. Change may come too, or a sparkling moment of praise and beauty might be found in the middle. It might not look how we think it might look, and it might not come when we hope it will come, but God has not left us behind. My friend still struggles with depression, so thankfully not to the same intensity as he once did. I'm not sure what the rest of his journey with depression will look like, how long the season might last for him. But I do know that God is with him in the thick of it, and he will delight in the absence of this darkness, either through healing in this life or in heaven. Let's take a few more breaths together. Hakiroto. Hakiwaho. Hakiroto. Hakiwaho. Hakiroto. Hakiwaho. Hakiroto. Hakiwaho. Verse 2 says, through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avengers. There's some powerful language right there. But did you notice what God uses to establish his stronghold against our enemies? Through the praise of children and infants. Isn't that just a babble or a cry? I'm yet to meet a baby who can praise God in a really articulate way. That period of life is known for its different form of communication, you know, a bit of a babble, cry, sometimes a yell. And yet, that is what God chooses to work through. He works through the powerless so that his strength can be seen, so that his protection can be seen. We don't have to try and be articulate or try and use fancy words to cry out to God. We can simply cry out to God. A few months ago, when I was reading a book about heaven, I stumbled on this quote by Richard Middleton. He says, in the biblical worldview, mountains and stars worship God just as much as humans do. And this can be seen in Psalm 148. But how do mountains and stars worship God? Certainly not verbally or with emotions. Rather, mountains worship God simply by being mountains, and stars worship God simply by being stars. If mountains worship God by being mountains and stars worship God by being stars, how do humans worship God? By being human in the full glory of what that means. Humans, the Bible tells us, are cultural beings, defined not by our worship, for worship is what defines creation. All creatures are called to worship. But the human creature is made to worship God in a distinctive way, by interacting with the earth, using our God-given power to transform our earthly environment into a complex world that glorifies the Creator. Creation worships just by being. I think we can sometimes get confused that sung worship is the only form of worship, or maybe the most superior form of worship. But what Richard Middleton is saying is that creation worships by being and responding in the way we were designed to. As people, we get to enjoy God's presence, enjoy being in creation, in nature, and worship by being who we were called to be and transforming the garden into a garden city. Creation is the echo of God's beauty. We get to enjoy God's creation around us and participate with God works amongst it, just how he is at work within us. So as we gradually prepare to leave this place today, and I invite the band up when they're ready, how are you going to engage with God's beauty in creation? I'm a big fan of sparkling moments. When thinking about a storm, a sparkling moment could be a rainbow, which is a sign of hope. If you are in the midst of hardship or chaos, I challenge you to look for those sparkling moments. It might be finding joy in someone else's wins, or watching a sparrow outside your window at work. Sometimes we also need to hold hope on behalf of others and help to point out the glimpses and beauty amongst the storm they're experiencing. That bird, that rainbow, creation is an echo of God's beauty, and we get to enjoy it. We have participated in some breathing together today. God can be glorified through our breath, through our focus on him, setting our gaze upon his face, basking in his presence. There don't have to be any specific thoughts attached to it. You can just focus on your breath. This is one of the tools I use in my everyday life. It helps me to slow down and actually pay attention to what's going on around me. A really easy way to turn this into a communal practice is going through your senses. Maybe this afternoon you choose to go out for a walk in your neighborhood with your family or your friends or your flatmate, just to take some time to pay attention to the beauty that's around you that maybe you've missed before. What can you see? I'm sure you can list many things with this sense, but what stands out to you? What can you feel? What can you hear? Are there leaves crunching under your feet? What can you smell? Is there rain in the air? Maybe it's freshly cut grass. And the last sense is, what can you taste? Maybe you already have a spot that you love, like the ice cream tree. I encourage you to take some time in that place this week and use it as an opportunity to recognize God's goodness in your life. I encourage you, as we move into this time of worship, to think about a practical way you can engage with creation once you leave this place today. For now, let's spend some time together in worship, thanking God for the love he has poured out in creation and to us. O Yahweh, our Yahweh, how majestic is your name in all the earth.